Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome to Administrative Static. This is John Vecchione. I'm here with Mark Chenoweth. And I want to talk about a problem that has been kind of highlighted by Charles Cook, National Review, in an article he did this week. Let's see what the date on it is. It was November 9th.
And, is that C-O-O-K, John?
Yeah, C-O-O-K-E.
Ah, okay.
And so he has noticed that the Biden administration says that it's a return to norms and that they're going to do things by the book. That was kind of what they said when they were coming in. And yet they're using executive power and administrative power in such a way that clearly goes outside the bounds of what it's there for. And he notes the CDC. Mark and I have talked about the CDC eviction notice order many, many times. And just a quick recap, that was started under the Trump administration, that the CDC said, well, in our powers, we're going to say that you can't use the state courts to evict tenants who are in arrears anymore. Now, they had no more power to do that than the man in the moon. And yet it took years and years until they stopped. And they still haven't admitted they don't have the power. It's just there was a stay issued out of D.C. after many, many years and going up to the Supreme Court twice.
Vec, I think that's a really important point, that they still to this day have not admitted that they lack the power to do what they did, or that they overreached in an unconstitutional way, or a way that completely lacked statutory authority.
So, but they did stop. A lot of landlords had to either sell their property. Some people went into bankruptcy. I mean, it was an absolute disaster. And it was completely unlawful. And there's no remedy to any. Well, there may be a remedy. We have some, we know some folks who are suing on this, in the Court of Federal Claims. And God willing, there will be some comeuppance for this huge overreach that's financial as well. But it's difficult. Let's put it that way. It's difficult. It's not a walk in the park. And then you have what just happened in the Fifth Circuit.
There's going to be no penalty for the bureaucrats who did this, though. That's the
correct. Correct.
That's not going to happen.
Nothing will happen to them. And it was over many administrations. So it's not like it's a Democrat Republican thing. It seems to be the office.
Perhaps the administrative state.
Yeah, exactly. So what's going on here? So then now we have these vaccine mandates of various stripes and types. I won't go into all of them. We will have a segment after this on one of our cases. But certainly the OSHA, all right, which is the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, has suddenly claimed a power to tell private employers as part of their OSHA regulations, anyone over 100 employees has to have all those employees vaccinated or has to fire them. Now that, and they actually say that this is because we want to get the general vaccination numbers up, not that your health place is unhealthy. It'd be one thing if OSHA, and a lot of people have a problem with OSHA statute at, just as it's written, which that's fine. But let's put it this way. Whatever OSHA can do, it might say, you know what, you need X amount of ventilation. Or your offices have to have this kind of ventilation if you're going to have this many employees in it, or something like that. That might be a health and safety situation. Certainly, they regulate, you know, smoke and other things
fumes
like that.
Fumes and all sorts
fumes.
Of things like
you
that.
Got it. But they're things that a normal average person would say, yeah, that's probably the health and safety of the occupation. You know, if you're working with dust or any of that stuff. So okay, fine. But here, for another policy the government wants to do, they're using this administrative agency for purposes that the statute doesn't provide for. And it got, in the Fifth Circuit, stayed the operation of this this regulation. It's not supposed to go into effect till January. They've extended the time to January 4th. But the Fifth Circuit said, basta, stop until we can look at this. And what they said is the petitions, meaning the petition to the Fifth Circuit, give cause to believe there are grave statutory and constitutional issues with the mandate. Grave. They don't use that language all the time. And our colleague, Sheng Li, quickly put together a amicus brief on behalf of NCLA that we put in last week as well, because we also think that these problems are grave and that it's highly illegal, not just regularly illegal. I don't want to be like Demi Moore saying I object strenuously, but exactly. But I do object strenuously, and I do believe that it's highly illegal. It's not like this is a close question. It's not even a close question. I think that's the real basis of the stay there.
I think the government knows that there's no basis for it. That's the other concerning thing here.
So there should be, we've discussed many times how hard it is to get an injunction, how hard it is to get a stay because the standards are so high, because they don't want you to get everything you want before you've proved your case. That's one of the main reasons why. So they want, but you want to stay on an injunction to preserve the status quo while the courts figure it out. But getting that is not always easy because they just say, oh, you'll get money damages someday in the sweep by and by. Well, losing your job, yeah, maybe there's money damages against somebody for that. But can you imagine you have to get a lawyer? How many years is that going to be? So you lose your seniority, all kinds of things. But I do think that this is becoming more and more common, and the Fifth Circuit at least has stopped this for now, and we'll see what happens. But I there is another thing, but that didn't stop the executive. The administration still says, well, we still think all employers should be doing this. So they're telling all these employers, the executive, which runs all these administrative agencies, which can impact these companies. If you have more than 100 employees, there's plenty of federal agencies that can mess with you. There's the Department of Labor, for instance. I mean, there are tons of agencies, and what they're doing is saying, you know, nice business you have there. Shame if anything would happen to it, you know. So even the stay from the Fifth Circuit hasn't stopped the pressure on these various companies to do this. And these drugs haven't been fully approved by the FDA. It's not like they're having you take a fully approved drug either. So, and they're going to put it all on the employers. And who is the employees going to sue down the road? They're going to sue the federal government. They're going to sue the employer. So it's highly illegal. It causes all kinds of problems.
And if they're injured, you mean? Who are they going to sue if they're injured? Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Well, even if they're fired, what if they're fired and it violates some state law to do this? I could create a cause of action saying that they I had a right to my own medical care and they overrode that or something like this. I mean, who knows what the state laws are? There's 50 states and you never know what the heck could be in the statute somewhere on this sort of thing. But I also think that the executive doing this all the time, it's become a feature and it's become a big feature. We've talked about it for a while, but I think this century, it's just gotten more and more and more. And it's not just in foreign policy where traditionally the president's allowed to do a lot of things and courts have been leery of going after, of stopping him. And the Congress is leery of stopping him because that's sort of foreign policy is looked as the president's thing. Now they're doing it domestically. They're doing it while we have a Congress in session. They're doing it while we have a Senate in session. And they're not asking the Congress or the Senate to do these things. They're just saying, oh, yeah, all the powers we wanted, we already have.
We have a House and Senate in session of the same party as the president. And he's still not going to them asking for them to provide authorization for what he wants to do.
Yeah, that is the amazing thing. Because let's say, okay, you say there's a filibuster, right? But at least you put the argument before the American people, you'd see what your party has to say about it. You'd take the temperature of at least the House of Representatives. I mean, that is elected dictatorship. If you got the votes, you get anything through. Well, can they pass something like this?
Well, and it's supposed to be hard to do things that have such huge nationwide effects on people. It's not supposed to be easy.
but not, it is not supposed to be easy, but if you have a good idea, you, why would you not propose it? If it was popular and it was a good idea, even if you lost the votes because of the legislative process, wouldn't you advance the ball for whatever you wanted to do? I mean, I just think that it's kind of outrageous that this OSHA thing's just going through, and the courts have to stop it, but Congress isn't doing anything. Where, and on the other side, I haven't seen any bills that, you know, no funds shall be used by OSHA to enforce this, right? You don't see that on the other side being introduced that I've seen. Have you seen anything like that, Mark? I don't.
I haven't seen it, but I bet it's coming. That seems, I mean, it won't go anywhere for the next year, but I could imagine that being introduced. The thing I have seen is some folks at the state level suggesting that they have the ability to sort of, I guess there are state level OSHA plans that states can put into place. You can either sort of take the federal regime or you can do your own regime that meets certain standards. And this is not an area of expertise for me, but it looks like there are some states that are looking for a workaround. I'm not sure if it's there or not. Maybe we can get into that on another show.
Yeah. Now that's interesting. That's an interesting offer because the states are suing. Some of the states are suing. So there's that, but you know, why do they have to sue when there's, I mean, there should be, the first break should be the president saying, I'm not going to do this because I don't have this power. But it appears that we can't ever get a president like that when something's important to them.
When the president has a pen and a phone,
yes,
the court needs something more than a gavel a year later. I mean, that's
exactly. Or two years you know, later.
Right. I mean, it reminds me of that scene from Dirty Harry when Clint Eastwood tells the boss, your mouthwash ain't cutting it. You know, I mean, this 2 year delay on stopping the administrative state, which is going at breakneck speed, is not cutting it.
All right. We'll be back with an example. Welcome back to Administrative Static. And now we're going to talk a little bit about one of our cases that we filed Friday, Rodden versus Fauci. And this was filed in the Southern District of Texas in Galveston. And we've asked for a TRO and an injunction. And
that's a temporary restraining order for our non-legal audience.
Correct. And this has to do with the federal employee mandate. We filed it as a class action. And what we're asking for is that people who have had COVID and who take an antibody test and can show that they have natural immunity, they come under the exceptions of people who do not have to be vaccinated under this federal mandate. And there's a number of reasons for this. Number one, there's no scientific evidence that the vaccine can aid these people or aid the people around them. Because the way a vaccine is made is that it's supposed to mimic natural immunity. That's kind of how they're made. And I'm not a scientist, but I do have some reading in this area. And that's kind of how you make a vaccine.
I thought you were going to say, but you play one on the radio.
No. But I do. So what's happened here is once again, the bureaucracy has decided that a bunch of vaccines that don't do a good job, let's put away Johnson and Pfizer and all that. The government has said to its federal employees that if you get one of these foreign vaccines that are, you know, 50-50, like near worthless, if you get one of those, then you don't have to get any of these vaccines. Those are good enough. But natural immunity, we're not going to look into at all. And we don't care about your antibodies. And it's kind of crazy because from a scientific perspective, what you want in the population in any pandemic or endemic disease is you want to increase immunity in the population. One of the ways you do that, in the main way, hopefully for a deadly disease, is vaccine. But if people are already immune, why should they risk even the small chance of side effects from it? And they should be able to say no, particularly when you're letting all these other people say no, who are less protected and less protected to other people too. So,
and John, early on in the pandemic, before we had the vaccine, when folks talked about herd immunity, that's what they were talking about, right? They were talking about people who had already recovered from COVID and had some immunity built up. And if you had enough of those people, then you would get to herd immunity even without the vaccine, was the theory. I'm not sure that they, you know, that they still believe that would happen given all the, you know, variations and everything that were cropping up. But that was the natural immunity was the concept behind herd immunity, right?
It always is. The problem is how many people die while you're getting it, right? So
right.
You're trying to avoid that. But,
sure.
But exactly. Before there were vaccines, I mean, that's how you got immunity. That's how pandemics stopped. I mean, they stopped once everybody had natural immunity. It's just we now have vaccines, so we can stop the negative part of that, which is people getting sick and dying. So our suit is just for people who've had it and can demonstrate by test that they have the immunity that the vaccine is supposed to give you. And the government won't back down on it. Certain state mandates do allow this. But the federal government, once again, has decided that it wants to vaccinate people. And so what is it aiming for? Vaccination? Why is it just aiming for vaccination against people's rights? And one of the reasons we're doing this case is because it has nothing to do with vaccinations. How many intrusive medical procedures can the government order federal employees to have just because they're federal employees? So there's been a number of these mandates. There's the OSHA rule we talked about, which is just because if you have a company with 100 employees, they say they can do it. There's the government contractor one, right? So now the government contractor one is if you have a contract with the federal government, they can say that you have to have all vaccinated employees or they'll terminate your contract or you got to fire them or something. And then you have the federal employees. Now, each of these has a different amount of control the federal government should have over them. But the basics of this is if you're a federal employee, can the government just order you to do anything? If it's worried that you're overweight, can it order you in? I always say, can you order you into liposuction? Can it say, oh, you've got to knock off 25 pounds or we'll take it off? I mean, there is no juridical or logical reason why the answer to that question I just asked isn't yes, if you can be completely as immune as you can be to the COVID strains. And they still can force you to be vaccinated, which is not medically required. And even if your doctor doesn't think you should be vaccinated, they don't take a doctor's note either on this. If a doctor says, I think that the risks to them of the vaccine are higher than the benefits to them or the surrounding people, the government doesn't even take that. So that is really crazy. I mean, that is absolutely nuts because it's not somebody coming off the street. These are people who are treating the actual folks who are bringing the suit.
Well, and it's unprecedented too.
Well, that is as well. There's a lot of unprecedented. First of all, quarantining people who aren't sick is the first time we've done that. Forcing vaccines on this. Now, there's also, we didn't talk about one. There's also the military vaccine order, but that's a different thing for historical and legal reasons. The law does say things about the president being able to vaccinate soldiers. Now, whether there's ways to constitutional things about that, I can't opine on, but it's a different sort of thing. But it doesn't say that he can do that to federal employees just because they're federal employees.
And I think that's why the military folks are not included in the class that you filed the suit in, partly because the law is different with regard to military folks. Is that exactly?
I think it's important. And for our case, I think it's important because if the law says that the president by doing X can force vaccines, at least that's a law passed by Congress, right? Whether it stands up to constitutional muster or not, we'll see. I'm sure we have other people challenging that. And I don't want to opine against them in any way. And they may be right. But that there's a constitutional argument against that. But here we have a statutory argument that we have. Number one, the statute says, okay, you can do this to soldiers, but it doesn't say you can do that to federal employees. So where does the power come from? And then the other thing is the emergency use authorization says that you get informed consent to refuse the vaccine. Well, is it informed consent if you're going to lose your job? I don't think so. I don't think that's what that means. So we've got statutory arguments against it. And really.
And just to clarify, Vivek, if I remember correctly, the complaint you drafted includes constitutional claims in the complaint, but you're correct. Just saying that the TRO and the preliminary injunction are based on these statutory claims.
Yes. Primarily. Yes. The fact is that it's the constitutional, you have a right to your bodily integrity. That's the basis of why you get it. But the reason why they can't override that is because the statutes don't even contemplate them doing it. Because in any constitutional litigation like this, number one, you have to have a constitutional right or ability. And then the other thing is the statute has to then tell the government it's allowed to do X, Y, or Z in contravention of those rights. And then you fight that battle. But we're fighting a battle before that, which is that none of these statutes allow you to do this. I mean, it's not a fight between the Constitution and the statute. It's a fight between the administrative agency and the Constitution without basis in the statute, which goes back to our last segment. I mean, that's really what's going on here. When they claim power they don't have at all is different from when they claim power based on a statute and say, you know, the Constitution allows this statute. So, but the administrative state moves beyond its statutory power all the time.
There's something called the major questions doctrine that the Supreme Court has talked a lot about in the last several years.
Talk about that.
Well, it essentially means that I think the way Justice Scalia put it was that you can't that the Congress does not hide elephants in mouse holes. That was sort of his famous way of putting it. But it means that Congress doesn't have a statute, whether it's the OSHA statute that John's been talking about, or if it's the emergency use authorization statute. Congress doesn't give vast amounts of power to do things like force vaccinate people without saying so. That's just not the way it works. And courts should recognize that and should be very reluctant to find new power in old statutes in the case of OSHA. Or the EUA statute is relatively recent. It's less than 20 years old. But there, Congress explicitly says in that the commander-in-chief may be able to have soldiers vaccinated, but it doesn't say anything about other federal employees. In fact, it says you have to have informed consent. So the idea that somehow that statute gives power to the agency, it really fights against this major questions doctrine that the Supreme Court has been adhering to.
Exactly. So that is so when an administrative agency suddenly says it has the power to reorient entire swaths of the economy, the court should look at those claims with a jaundiced eye, because many of our agencies were put together. The SEC, right? There was a stock market crash. There was all kinds of, hey, what happened here? It was created to do certain things in the securities industry. Like, that's what its name is. And others, labor, there were all labor unrest. So it was there to stop labor unrest. Well, if it suddenly says, no, we're not here to stop labor unrest, we're here to reorient all of society, then you've got to look at that. You've got to look at that claim and say, well, wait a minute. Why are you shooting rockets to the moon? You're the Labor Department. But, you know, it's just you can't say I'm an agency and I've now through many, many links linked this to my mission. And so I'm allowed to do it. But that's what they're trying to do here again and again and again. And it's not like we don't have a lot of agencies and we don't have a lot of laws. there's plenty of them. So and they have a lot of power and yet they seem always to want to go beyond it. It's really astounding.
Well, and it interferes with self-government, right? The whole point of the way the Constitution is built is so that the people get a voice in these decisions. And when it's the agencies doing this rather than Congress doing it, then the people's voice is lost and self-government is no more.
That's right. You don't know who to blame. That's the other thing. I mean, no congressman is responsible for this OSHA rule because no congressman passed a law allowing it. And we'll be back in a moment.